So this 2022 version of the iPhone SE is currently the latest and the most affordable iPhone, starting with a price from only 2,099 ringgit. But there have been lots of negativity coming from tech reviewers surrounding this phone, making this a so-called forbidden fruit. Well, let's find out if that's really true. Now, starting from the unboxing, the box comes in white with the visuals of the phone in front. Then at the back, there's the storage option that you choose and the color variant as well. Opening the box, you will immediately find the phone itself. Underneath, towards the top, there's the documentation, the SIM ejector pin, the Apple sticker, and the product rate leaflet where, in case you did not know, is when Apple will contribute a portion of the iPhone's purchase to the Global Fund to support HIV or AIDS programs. Then finally, below that, there's the USB-C to Lightning cable. Next, let's talk about the build and the design. Now, disclaimer, I only started using an iPhone daily from iPhone 12 onwards. So as much as I'm aware with the build quality and the design being very similar to previous versions of the iPhone SEs and the iPhone 8, I never got to use them daily, so this is my first time experience. Now, from the build quality's perspective, coming from using the iPhone 13 Pro Max daily, there's lots of difference obviously, but not in a bad way. Now, first of all, because I have a medium-sized hand, so of course the phone felt super easy to use with just one hand. Now, at the back, it is made out of the similar rear glass to the current iPhone 13 lineup, which is really pleasing to know. Now, even though it had a very slim profile at 7.3mm, now because of the sides are made of a matte finish, it made gripping the phone daily super easy as well, where there was no anxiety of dropping the phone to the point that I didn't even use a case when I was using this phone daily, as it was also really light at only 144 grams as well. And of course, I really did appreciate the fact that the phone also had an official IP67 dust and water resistant, as this would be something that Apple could have done without, because since this is an affordable option of the iPhones. So kudos to Apple for including that, as most smartphones within this range doesn't have such IP rating. Next, looking at the ports and buttons, other than the Lightning port below, there's one of the two stereo speakers towards the right, where the other speaker grill on the left is for aesthetic purposes, as the other stereo speaker is at the earpiece area. Then there's the volume rocker and the physical ring and silence switcher on the left. Then as for the right side, there's the power button and the SIM card slot. And I have to say that I really enjoyed the physical home button, which has Touch ID that unlocked the phone very quickly, which gave me that old school retro vibe when I was using a home button on an Android phone. Now, as for the phone screen, it comes with a 4.7-inch Retina display, which has an IPS LCD display. And I have to say that I've seen lots of IPS LCD displays, and I have to say that this has to be the best that I've currently seen. Now, yes, of course, I would prefer an OLED screen, but considering the price, that is to be expected. Then in terms of the resolution, it has a HD display of 1,334x750 pixels. And once again, because the quality of the IPS display was really good, it still looked great with excellent viewing angles compared to some budget AMOLED screens which had horrible viewing angles and color reproduction. Now, I know it may seem that I'm just giving a sort of justification for the phone screen, but trust me, if you have been following my channel for a while, you would know that I review lots of budget smartphones and I've seen so many different types of screen qualities, and I have to say that this has to be one of the best when it comes to having a very good IPS LCD display. Then the screen has up to 625 nits of brightness, and there were no issues of using the phone in bright daylight as well. and it has HDR10, can playback HEVC, H.264 and even ProRes video files as well, which is something that no other smartphones can do within this price range. That is a guarantee. As for playback on Netflix, what's super nice is that it has Dolby Vision support and even on Disney Plus Hotstar as well. Now, one thing that took me a while to get used to is the amount of screen real estate when watching videos on the phone, because I'm very used to an edge-to-edge kind of display, so I kept stretching the screen to maximize the video. But other than that, the viewing experience on the phone was really nice, especially when it comes to the color reproduction. Now, as for the phone's camera specs, the iPhone SE 2022 has a single 12-megapixel f1.8 aperture lens, and the front has a 7-megapixel f2.2 aperture lens. Now, here's where there were complaints about how the hardware specs of the camera is not on par with the 2022 standards, but here is the thing, guys. I'd rather have a damn good single lens rather than having 25 lenses that consist of a dedicated bokeh lenses, a black and white lens, an ultra spectrum lens, a dedicated macro lens that is famous, and a grandma lens. I miss my grandma. Because yes, the hardware is from the previous generation iPhone, but ultimately we need to know if the hardware is still great, and of course the software's image processing, whether or not is flawless too. And that is a huge yes, because the A15 Bionic chipset made all the photos look as close as their flagship smartphones, with features like the photographic styles, deep fusion and other software enhancements. These are all the features which was brought into the phone, making the pictures look really great. And because of the smart HDR4, there is an overall fantastic dynamic range, details and way better skin tone and overall color separation as well. Then the portrait mode for the rear cameras also performed exceptionally well, even though it has just a single lens. And there was another common complaint where people were mentioning about how and why the phone does not have a dedicated night mode. Well, check these images out, because these photos were taken at night without the dedicated night mode, which performed very well compared to non-night mode smartphones that I've tested before. Now, as for the front camera's performance, one might think that having a 7-megapixel camera may not perform very well when it comes to taking selfies, but check out these photos, because not only the regular selfies look really great, the portrait mode selfies not only performed very well during the day, but also at night as well. Then as for video, the rear camera can record up to 4K 60 frames per second. Then on the 30 frames per second frame rate, the image stabilization was great and the video quality was really good with lots of dynamic range. And the front camera can record up to 1080p 30 frames per second. And check out the great image stabilization and also the amount of dynamic range at the sky area, where typically the exposure for the sky would be totally blown out for similar smartphones within this price range once again. And yes, here is a quick video and audio test on the phone. So this is a front video audio and also the recording test for you all to see and hear how exactly it is. You can see that image stabilization is great, but audio quality though, we have to see how exactly it performs when it comes to using the front camera for any vlogging situation. So here is where you can be the judge. So with this, do let me know what you think of the camera's performance, especially with a single lens camera like this. And if you're finding this video helpful so far, a nice big thumbs up would be very much appreciated, and a subscription to the channel would be very sweet. Now, when it comes to the software, this iPhone SE ships with iOS version 15, where the current version that I was at during this review was at version 15.4.1. And because of the latest A15 Bionic chipset and 5G support for those countries who has full support for 5G, we are still not there yet here in Malaysia, you would expect a swift and a seamless experience when using the phone daily. And I'm happy to note that although the keyboard was way smaller than my larger screen on the iPhone 13 Pro Max, but I almost never made a typing mistake where I didn't even need to make those swiping keyboard gestures. Then the phone also has Wi-Fi 6, so I had great and consistent connection without having any problems over here. However, from a software's perspective, something which I was not used to at first, which took me about a day to get used to, was the navigation gestures. Where this was totally new to me, where if you want to go to the recent apps, you will need to double click on the home button instead of swiping up and holding onto the screen. Then going into the control center is by swiping up from below instead of swiping on the top right, and then swiping down from the top left of the screen goes to my notification menu. And finally, to take a screenshot is through holding the power button and the home button as well. Now, the reason why this is new to me, as I mentioned, is because this is the very first time that I'm using an iPhone which has the home button, so I may be totally new to this, which is a great thing because I don't have any physical connection with the previous versions. But of course, if you're familiar with the previous iPhone SE models or even the iPhone 8, then you will be very much at home using this particular smartphone. Now, the battery life for the previous generation iPhone SE was something which was a common complaint that users and even tech reviewers alike mentioned. And it is nice that Apple has fixed that issue on this iteration of the iPhone SE. As I got an average of 3 hours and 39 minutes of screen on time with very heavy usage. Now, here's where you would definitely get more battery life when it comes to smartphones within this price range. So this is probably the only Achilles heel of the phone. And the iPhone SE can support up to 20 watts of fast charging. And I also do appreciate there is wireless charging on the phone. Again, something which most smartphones within this price range does not have. Then when it comes to gaming, thanks to the A15 Bionic chipset, once again, the gaming performance on the phone was really great. Then when it comes to gaming on Genshin Impact, I tested the game at high settings at 60 frames per second, where it ran smoothly with no micro lag or stutter issues. Now, the phone did become a bit warm within 5 minutes of gameplay, where the only part that became warm is the top left of the camera and also a little on the frame. And the good news is there is no battery drain issue unless if you're playing it at the highest settings for about 45 minutes to 1 hour when playing Genshin Impact continuously. Then as for PUBG Mobile, it was at Ultra HD settings where the frame rate was also at Ultra. Now it was super smooth and very optimized as expected, where there's no stutter or any micro lag at all. And of course, since the game is very optimized, there was no battery issues and the phone also feels very comfortable in the hand during my very long gameplay due to the phone size and the overall frame finish. So in conclusion, the iPhone SE 2022 is a smartphone that I would totally recommend because there is still a large percentage of people who kind of prefers a smaller form factor smartphone that fits into your pocket easily. And there are many people who are still using the iPhone 7 or even the iPhone 8 who could totally benefit from making the switch to this phone without worrying about spending too much. And I feel that the iPhone SE is indeed the right formula. That is a great performing smartphone within a very good price range as well. Because Apple always supports their smartphones for 5 or even 7 years when it comes to software updates. And speaking of switching, if you're someone who wants to make a switch from the Android to an iPhone without breaking the bank, well, this would be the natural recommendation.